does a lot of all kinds of stuff, Professor Dave explains.
Sometimes in a free market economy, which we defined earlier in the series as one that is based on supply and demand rather than any kind of government control, we need the government to provide certain goods and services that the marketplace cannot. Take this publicly accessible bridge, for example. This bridge is a public good, or a shared good, and it doesn't make sense to force consumers to pay individually to use the bridge, or to somehow prohibit those who didn't pay from using the bridge. The bridge is for everyone, and actually it helps the overall economy. So how is the bridge paid for? Well, to simplify the funding of government projects in the public interest, the government collects taxes. Citizens of a society pay taxes to a government, and that government in turn takes some of that money to build and maintain that bridge. Imagine the arguments and traffic congestion that would occur if drivers who refused to pay to use the bridge were told they had to turn around and drive away. With this bridge, as with most public goods, it is impractical to exclude non-payers from its use. Another characteristic that makes this bridge a public good is that any number of consumers can use it without reducing the benefits to any one person using it. For the most part, increasing the number of drivers on the bridge does not increase the cost of providing the bridge. Public goods are paid for by what is known as the public sector. Every other part of the economy is paid for by the private sector. The most common public goods make up a nation's infrastructure, or the basic facilities that are necessary for a society and economy to function and grow efficiently. What should or shouldn't be a public good often leads to political debate. After all, whenever tax dollars are involved, taxpayers generally want to see those tax dollars align with their own values and beliefs. Generally, the following questions guide the debate about whether or not something should be classified as a public good. Number 1. Is the benefit to each individual greater if the good remains private? Number 2. Is the benefit to society greater if the good becomes public? Take education, for example. To answer the first question, if education were exclusively private, it's possible that it would be run more efficiently, and many individuals might be better off. But to answer the second question, it is important for any society to have an educated populace, and the easiest way to achieve this is to guarantee a basic education for everyone. So in a grander context, it makes sense for education to be a public good. One issue associated with public goods is called the free rider problem. A free rider is someone who is not willing to pay for a certain good or service, but still gets the benefit if it were provided as a public good. Unlike consumers in a pure free market, free riders consume what they don't directly pay for. However, the free rider problem is inevitable. For example, you likely wouldn't voluntarily pay money to build highways in a state you don't live in. However, you could still benefit from that state building a highway, as that highway would make it easier for trucking companies to bring goods to your state. And if you were traveling somewhere across the country and drove through that state, you would probably be quite happy to drive on its highways. The free rider problem predicts what would probably happen if the government stopped collecting taxes to fund public goods. If it relied entirely on voluntary contributions instead, many citizens would use the services but simply refuse to give money, and thus many public goods would no longer be available due to lack of funding. The example of driving on a highway in another state that you did not directly pay for is also known as an externality. An externality is an economic side effect. It's essentially a cost or benefit a third party receives. That third party has no control over the creation of that cost or benefit. An externality can be both positive or negative, and can come from either the production or consumption of a good or service. Let's go back to the bridge we started with. Positive externalities of that bridge being built include aiding drivers in getting across the river, increasing tourism, creating construction jobs which are filled by local workers, and increasing traffic to local businesses. However, negative externalities of the bridge could include the increased traffic and construction lowering the air quality in the area, the ecology of the river being altered leading to fish dying, the bridge driving a local ferry company out of business, or even an increase in suicides. Often when we think about negative externalities, we think of the private sector. Think of a company dumping toxic waste into the ocean or some similar cliché. However, many economists believe that the private sector generates positive externalities more efficiently than the public sector can, and at a lower cost to taxpayers. Whether private or public, positive externalities allow someone who did not purchase a good or service to enjoy at least some of the benefits of that good. We will learn more about how governments handle public goods and externalities when we begin to examine macroeconomics, or the study of the economy as a whole. For now, let's continue by examining the labor force.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.